you're operating at a different level of the curve, right? I think that's one way of putting it. But I do want to get your reaction to that OpenAI Nvidia deal, because it's all of it that's happening in the market right now.
Right, and thank you for having me. It's great to be back. It's both surprising in scale, but not surprising that it's happening. Number one, I think we're undershooting or underestimating how much compute we need for not only training, but for inference. That growth in demand is scaling out in every direction right now. We're seeing that across early stage startups, as well as growth stage startups and public companies. So if you think about what's happening today, globally, first off, every region is now in the AI competition, the model competition race. Number two, there are specialized models in video, in audio, in voices, in speech models,
yes.
Physics models, medical science models. You look at what DeepMind is doing. You look at what small startups like Sofont are doing in medical sciences. And then you also see what's happening in particular with demand. And so we're just moving from an experimental phase into a commercial application phase. So everything that's happened up until today has just been in that experimental testing phase. And so if you think about TikTok and Instagram and YouTube on the consumer level, there's double-digit adoption right now on creators and users there using AI tools. And then if you look at enterprises and small businesses, they're already starting to use voice AI for call centers.
Right.
They're using it to write reports. They're using it for search and answers. So we're just at the beginning, and I think every single I looked back yesterday before
yeah.
we came on today, and I saw all the projections from a year ago, and we're already surpassing that by 10x today, inference demand alone.
But Steve, the reason we come to you is because the prowess of the bets that you've already met, and we think about Perplexity and we think about Play AI. How do you ensure, Steve, that you're not part of what some are starting to feel is like a house of cards, of everyone giving money to the same sort of players? And ultimately, if the productivity doesn't achieve, if the money doesn't achieve, then suddenly we start to see some real holes.
I think what's important here is that you do see the demand and you do see the uptake commercially. You see revenues, you see adoption, you see usage. I'll give you an example of this. So today, in terms of generative media, generative video is relatively new. Well, let's say it's about a year and a half old. Google, ByteDance, and many other small startups are providing these models. The compute just for that, which is showing up on YouTube, which is showing up in video ads, which is now showing up through Creatify on Comcast and Universal Channel video ads now, is making real money. It's making real CPMs for real brands. And so as long as there is economic productivity on the demand side, that's why you're seeing all this scaling of cost of investment in GPUs, data centers, and energy. And you see these long-term contracts. $100 billion was an amazing size for a SoftBank Vision Fund 5 years ago. And today, that's just one company making an investment for a round-trip commercial deal.
Steve, you were in the green room, right, when Fabrizio Borghese was sat in that chair, and he talked about a bubble in the context that, like, well, that's normal part of the game. Some failures, you need to find successes. Do you think about it in those terms, in the context of there's such a capital concentration in
right.
these few names?
There's always going to be an arbitrage between current demand and economic productivity revenue, right? And the investment capital and the timeline in between. Bubbles are necessary for a collection and hyper-focus of talent, engineering talent, research talent, building talent, as well as capital. And that's what creates that enormous growth and velocity in any sort of tech cycle. We saw this every tech cycle. This tech cycle is very different because there's real revenue and commercial application happening. So again,
right.
look at GPUs as just one part of this. Energy is the other part. Data center space is the other. Then there's a software infrastructure layer there, so-called middleware, which was a bad word in the last tech cycle,
yes.
but is actually where value capture and differentiation happens now. And so this is really important. You see companies like Together AI, you see companies like Foul in the generative media cloud space. These companies, and CoreWeave. CoreWeave is a company that started out as Bitcoin
yes.
Mining data center.
Steve, can I go to that? Can I go to crypto? Because we're talking about a potential bubble, and I know that you've got a lot of experience in crypto. I'm looking at Tether, potentially looking at funding with a valuation of $500 billion. Is that a bubble sign to you or not?
The stable coins right now and crypto, there's an interesting thing happening right now where fintech, as we knew it, global payments infrastructure, companies like Stripe and many other companies fragmented around the world in FX, is getting slowly transformed by crypto, especially stable coins. Mm. It is, again, very easy to underestimate this. I think it's harder to really look at the frontier edge and say, how big could this be? But you see the U.S. government and many other foreign governments, this is an area, unlike AI, where there isn't a concept of sovereign crypto. In AI, we have sovereign AI, and there's a competition. In crypto, interestingly, there's much more of a cross-border collaboration that wants to be on blockchains. This is obviously very recent in terms of government push with this new administration, but underlying that is still compute. Same data centers that are providing AI compute, high-performance compute, are also supplying it for crypto.